Myself, Gnaneshwar Shinde, Associate Professor in Chemistry, Department of Chemistry, Professor Ramakrishna More College, Akurdi. Welcome all of you in the channel Chemistry Education. In this YouTube video, I am going to explain how water of crystallization is determined in the Mohr salt. To demonstrate practical, PowerPoint animation is prepared. PowerPoint animation is so designed that it gives rise the actual experience of performing the experiment like in the laboratory. So the video is very effective for the demonstration of this experiment. Watch the video, write the reading, perform the calculation and answer the questions asked at the end of the video.
So first of all, I will explain what is meant by water of crystallization. Water of crystallization are the definite number of water molecules associated with crystalline substance, and they are the characteristic of crystalline substance. For example, we are writing CuSO4 5H2O. What is the meaning of this 5H2O? These are the water molecules of crystallization. For example, we have MgSO4 7H2O. These are the 7 water molecules associated with crystalline magnesium sulfate, and they are definite in number. So if you see, water of crystallization is one of the important characteristic of many crystalline organic and inorganic substances. If you see water of crystallization, it is different from
absorbed water or moisture.
If you see the absorbed water, it is invariable amount. Okay, the definite thing. It is not definite, it is the invariable amount of water molecule that is associated with the substance. Okay, it is expelled when substance is heated up to 110 degrees Celsius. Then what is the characteristic of the water of crystallization? They are definite in number. Water of crystallization, it is definite in number, and these expelled from the crystalline substance when substance is strongly heated in between 120 to 400 degrees Celsius. So this is the major difference between water of crystallization and the moisture or absorbed water. In inorganic substances, these water molecule, they are associated with particularly metal ion, and they are weakly bonded, weakly coordinated with the metal ion. That's why they are not expelled easily from the crystalline substance or from the inorganic salt, and they require higher temperature. So what are the methods of determination of the water of crystallization? There are many methods, and among many methods, two methods that can be easily practiced in the undergraduate laboratory is the gravimetric method. What is done in the gravimetric method? Substance is taken, definite weight, it is heated strongly, and again weight is taken. So we get anhydrous substance plus water. For example, we have CuSO4 5H2O. You have heated it up to 400 degrees Celsius. What you will get? You will get CuSO4, and 5 water molecules are given out from the copper sulfate. So you will get anhydrous copper sulfate behind. okay? And this is the strategy. This is the strategy in the determination. Do it is possible, gravimetric method is possible for all the substances? No. The substance like ferrous ammonium sulfate is not heat stable. The substance which is not heat stable, for them water or crystallization cannot be determined by the gravimetric method. For example, we have ferrous ammonium sulfate, NH4 twice, Fe, SO4 twice, XH2O. What will happen when it is heated? It will form twice ammonia molecule as a gas. It will form FeSO4 plus it will form water. So it will lose water as well as ammonia. Hence, the gravimetric method is not suitable for the determination of water of crystallization for heat unstable substances. So what could be done for such a substances? We can use volumetric method. Volumetric method is very simple method and the accurate method for determination of water of crystallization for the heat unstable substances. Okay, now we have to determine water of crystallization in ferrous ammonium sulfate. So what should be the our strategy? What should be the or what is the basis for it? So we have to weigh accurate quantity of hydrated ferrous ammonium sulfate and prepare the solution. Titrate definite volume, known volume of ferrous ammonium sulfate solution against standardized potassium permanganate. So what happens? Mn plus 7 in KmnO4 react with ferrous ion and it form ferric ion plus Mn7 is reduced to the Mn plus 2. This is the chemical reaction taking place, and with the help of this chemical reaction we can determine quantity of Fe2 in the hydrated ferrous ammonium sulfate. Okay, so once we know the quantity of Fe2, we can calculate quantity of anhydrous ferrous ammonium sulfate. We can calculate the quantity of anhydrous ferrous ammonium sulfate. So we have two weights now. One weight is hydrated salt, another is anhydrous salt. So what you can do? You can take the difference between weight delta W, which is nothing but the amount of water present in the weighed quantity of hydrated ferrous ammonium sulfate. Okay, now from delta W you can calculate amount of water present in one mole of ferrous ammonium sulfate. Okay, and that is nothing but the water of crystallization. That is nothing but the water of crystallization. So whatever the weight of water present in 1 mole of anhydrous ferrous ammonium sulfate, divide it by 18, you will get water of crystallization. So this is the strategy. Okay, so what are the basic requirement for the titrimetric method? We'll require the burette, we will require the titration flask, we will require the oxalic acid, we will require the potassium permanganate, we will require ferrous ammonium sulfate solution and distilled water. Okay, these are the basic requirement. Apart from that, we require 2 molar sulfuric acid, we require measuring cylinder, glass rod, etc. The first step is the standardization of potassium permanganate. Now question is that why KMnO4 is to be standardized? It is secondary standard substance. And the solution of KMnO4 is unstable in air. And light. So when KMnO4 is prepared, it has approximate molarity, and hence the standardization is needed to know the accurate molarity of potassium permanganate. So what are the steps? Fill burette with respective solution. What it means that you have to fill burette 1 with the sodium oxalate solution, and we are preparing the sodium oxalate solution of 0.025 molar. Okay, so burette 1 we have to fill with sodium oxalate, and its molarity is exactly known, 0.025 molar. We have to fill second burette with potassium permanganate solution, and approximate molarity of potassium permanganate solution is 0.01 molar. Okay, so we are starting with standardization of KMnO4. We have filled burette 1 with sodium oxalate, burette 2 with potassium permanganate solution. Then from burette 1 we have to take out 9 ml sodium oxalate solution into the titration flask. Now just see, we are taking out 9 ml oxalate solution into the titration flask. Okay, you can see this burette. Okay, and this level of sodium oxalate is moving down continuously. Okay, so at 9 ml it will stop. It 9 ml it will stop. Yes. Once you have taken out the 9 ml sodium oxalate solution into the titration flask, we have to add 2 molar 10 ml sulfuric acid into it. Since this titration requires acidic medium, in the acidic medium reaction is fast. In the acidic medium reaction is fast. So we have added 2 molar sulfuric acid in the titration flask. Then this titration is carried out at higher temperature. At room temperature, the rate of reaction is very, very slow. So the titration flask or the sodium oxalate solution is heated up to 70 degrees Celsius, and then titration is performed. So place the burner and heat it. Okay. So approximately how we will find out temperature 70 degrees Celsius? When bubble start appearing from the bottom of flask, temperature is 70 degrees Celsius. So here you can see the heating is going on. Okay, so bubbles start appearing here. You can see the bubbles are appearing here. So approximately temperature of this flask is 70 degrees Celsius, which is sufficient to carry out the titration at fast rate. Okay, what is the next step? We have to add KMnO4 solution from the burette to drop wise. KMnO4 is the self indicator. We don't need any external indicator. So when all sodium oxalate is consumed from the burette, excess potassium permanganate will remain in the solution, and that will give rise pink color to the solution. Okay, so now we'll add the KMnO4 solution from burette to drop wise with constant stirring. So you can see here the stirring is going on, and from the burette you can see the level, it is continuously going down. So we will add KMnO4 solution till pink color appears to this solution, to the titration flask. Okay, go on observing till solution has the faint green color, which is of the fair. Okay, till color is not changed. Okay, so color change is there, pink color is there. So all sodium oxalate solution is consumed from the titration flask, pink color appear, and we have stopped the addition of potassium permanganate at this point. So now what we have to do? We have to record the burette reading. From burette 1, what we have taken out? Sodium oxalate, and we have taken out 9 ml of the sodium oxalate. Okay, now corresponding to this, from burette to KMnO4, what is the titration reading? 8.8 ml. You have to write down this reading. Okay, what is the next step? In the next step, we have to take out 1 ml oxalate solution again in the titration flask. We have to not discard this solution. In the same solution, take out 1 ml oxalate solution. Okay, so you can see here this oxalate solution has pink color, and into this solution we will add the color of solution will disappear. We will see what happens. Okay, so we have to add 1 ml, that is 9 to 10. Okay, so you can see the pink color has disappeared due to the addition of titration flask. Okay, so it should stop at 9 ml. At this point it will stop. Okay, so 9 to 10 we have taken out
1 ml sodium oxalate solution.
Okay, what will be the next step? Again titrate this solution with potassium permanganate from the burette 2. Okay, so we have the KMnO4 is level here, and we will start the titration. Okay, again up to what point? Till just pink color appears to the solution. Just pink color appears to the solution. You have to observe here. You have to observe here what happens to this solution when we are adding potassium permanganate from the burette. So go on observing. Yes. Okay, it is turn pink, so we have stopped here. So note down the burette reading. So the second for the 10 ml and the burette reading is 9.8 ml. Burette reading is 9.8 ml. Now once again we have to take out 1 ml solution into the same titration flask. We have to not discard the solution. And in the same titration flask, you have to take out 1 ml, the sodium oxalate solution. Okay, so total volume becomes 11 ml. First time 9, then 10, now the 11 ml. Now just see, we are taking out 1 ml solution. This pink color should disappear. Why? Since sodium oxalate react with potassium permanganate, and it oxidizes oxalate and releases KMnO4, so color disappears. Okay, so we have to take up to the 11 ml, up to this point. Okay, so we have taken out 11 ml of the sodium oxalate, 9, 10, 11. Now ultimately again we have to titrate against the potassium permanganate till pink color appears to the solution. Okay, so we'll start the titration. You have to observe here again, we have to stop the titration when pink color appears to this solution. Okay, till pink color is not appear, so we have to continue the titration. Okay, we must stop now. Yes, so this is the reading for 11 ml. This is the reading for 11 ml. So we have to note down the end point, and it is 10.6 ml. okay, so we have the three variant reading, 8.8, 9.8 and the 10.6. these are the three burette reading for 9 ml oxalate, for 10 ml oxalate and for 11 ml oxalate. From these three titration reading, what you have to do? You have to calculate accurate molarity of the potassium permanganate, accurate molarity of the potassium permanganate. So what you have to do? You have to take the mean of three burette reading. I have labeled this burette reading as x1, x2, x3. Sum of these three divided by three, you will get the mean. Okay, so molarity of KMnO4 into volume of KMnO4 is equal to molarity of sodium oxalate into volume of sodium oxalate. So why I have taken 10 here? The mean of 9, 10 and 11 is 10. That's why the volume of sodium oxalate is 10 ml. What is exact molarity? 0.025 molar. 0.025 molar. Okay. So here one point is remaining. We should divide this value. We should divide this value by 2.5. okay, I will explain afterward, but time being I will write down 10 divided by 2.5. so m2, exact molarity of potassium permanganate, is equal to 0.025 into 10 upon x, that is the mean, divided by 2.5. okay, so we have KMnO4 Mn plus 7 twice, plus we have Na2C2O4 Okay, we have Mn plus 7 plus 5 oxalate ion. They are reacting with each other and we are getting twice Mn2 plus 10CO2 in acidic medium. Okay, so here we have each sodium oxalate gives rise to electron, while each manganese gains 5 electron. So 5 divided by 2 giving rise 2.5. so this is the factor 2.5 appears, so that we will get the exact molarity of the KMnO4. Okay, So you have to calculate it. I will not show any calculation to you, but I have just given the basic part. So you have to write down exact molarity here. Now what is the second part? Second part is the estimation of iron 2. Estimation of iron 2. Again, the same strategy. We have to fill the burette with respective solutions. So we have taken 2.761 gram of ferrous ammonium sulfate and we have prepared 100 ml solution. And this ferrous ammonium sulfate solution is filled in this burette. Ultimately, second burette, we have to fill standardized potassium permanganate solution. Okay, this is the burette in which we have filled the standardized potassium permanganate. We have adjusted zero for both the burette. We have taken out whatever the air bubble inside. All this procedure is performed. Okay, what we have to do? Same strategy. In the first step, we have to take out 9 ml ferrous ammonium sulfate solution into the titration flask. Okay, so this is the titration flask, and from this burette, we have to take out 9 ml of the ferrous ammonium sulfate solution. Okay, so go on observing. So you can see we have started the addition, and this level is continuously going down. This level is continuously going down. Okay, so where it will stop? It should stop at 9 ml. It should stop at 9 ml. Okay, at this point. Sulfate into titration flask. Next step, we have to add 10 ml 2 molar sulfuric acid into it. Again, this requires the acidic condition. So we have added the 10 ml sulfuric acid into this solution. The titration flask is ready for the titration. Now we have to titrate it with potassium permanganate solution till pink color appears. Okay, so we have started the titration. You can see this level is moving down, and this addition we have to continue till pink color appears. Okay, still there is a faint green color. To the solution. Okay, go on observing the color change. Okay, till it is the color of ferrous ammonium sulfate. So reaction is not completed. Okay, so you have to observe here. Okay. Okay, now color change is there, so we have to stop the addition. So this is the reading. We have to note down the burette reading for the 9 ml of ferrous ammonium sulfate from the burette 1, and the reading is 12.2 ml. Next step, again you have to take out 1 ml solution from the ferrous ammonium sulfate. Okay, so here you can see we have not discarded the solution, so the pink color is as it is, and into that we will add the ferrous ammonium sulfate solution. And when we add ferrous ammonium sulfate solution, what will happen? The pink color should disappear. Okay, just see what happens. Okay, so pink color has disappeared when the ferrous ammonium sulfate is added. And we have to add up to this point, 10 ml. Okay, so we have completed the 10 ml addition. Okay, so the next step, we have to titrate this solution against potassium permanganate solution till pink color appears. Okay, so we will start the titration, and observe the color change at this point. Observe the color change at this point. Okay, when pink color appears to the solution, we have to stop till it is the color of ferrous ammonium sulfate. So addition is continued. Okay, so I will stop here. The reading is 13.6 ml, 10 ml. Reading is 13.6 ml. Next, again 1 ml ferrous ammonium sulfate we have to take out. So we are taking out it here. Okay. So we have to stop at 11 ml. We have to stop at 11 ml. Okay, so we have completed the 11 ml addition of the ferrous ammonium sulfate. Now again we will titrate with potassium permanganate till pink color appears. So we will start the titration. Okay, we will start the titration. Observe here. Yes. Okay. So if you see in the reading here, okay, we have to note down this reading. This reading is 14.8 ml. So we have three reading: 9 ml ferrous ammonium sulfate 12.2, 10 ml ferrous ammonium sulfate 13.6, 11 ml ferrous ammonium sulfate 14.8. So we have the burette reading with us. What we have to do? Now we will perform the calculation. First of all, we have to take the mean of the three burette reading, and the mean we will call it as a YML. So we have standard equation: 1 molar 1000 ml KMnO4 is equal to 1420.25 gram anhydrous Mohr salt. Anhydrous Mohr salt molecular weight is 284.05 gram. It is multiplied by 5. Why? Since 1 mole of KMnO4 require 5 moles of Mohr salt. 5 moles of Mohr salt, and this multiplication will be 1420.25. Okay, so such a high quantity you can see here. Therefore m molar, this is the molarity of the KMnO4 solution that we have practically find out in the first. Y is the mean that we have calculated here is equal to how much. Okay, so if we will get here, this is wrong, 1420.25 into m into y upon 1000. Okay, that will be the quantity of anhydrous Mohr salt in 10 ml. From where 10 ml came? We have used 9, 10 and 11 ml of ferrous ammonium sulfate. So mean of these three is 10 ml. How much original quantity of solution is 100 ml. So we must calculate in 100 ml. So if you call this quantity as AML, A into 10, that will give rise the quantity of anhydrous Mohr salt in 100 ml, that is in W gram of hydrated FAS, ferrous ammonium sulfate. Now we will calculate the water, amount of water in W gram, weighed quantity of hydrated Mohr salt. So W minus W1, W is weight of hydrated Mohr salt, W1 is calculated quantity of anhydrous Mohr salt. So suppose we'll call it as a W2 gram. It is the water associated with weighed quantity of Mohr salt. Now the next step in the calculation, calculate water of crystallization in 1 mole of the Mohr salt. We know that W1 gram anhydrous Mohr salt contains W2 gram of water of crystallization. So 284.05 gram, this is the 1 mole of Mohr salt is equal to how much? So this is the equation, W2 into 284.05 upon W1, that gives rise grams of water of crystallization in 1 mole of anhydrous Mohr salt. Now gram must be converted into the molecule. So number of grams divided by molecular weight. So W3 divided by 18. 18 is the molecular weight of water. Okay, you will get number of molecules of water of crystallization. Thus we have completed the calculation part. We have seen how to carry out standardization of potassium permanganate. We have seen how to find out quantity of the Fe2 ion, how to calculate ferrous anhydrous ferrous ammonium salt and water of crystallization. Okay, now express your result. Exact molarity of potassium permanganate that we have determined in the part 1. The number of molecules of crystallization as a integer. Here you may get fractional number. Round up figure and express in the integer. For example, suppose it is 4.3. Rounding up will be 4.0. Suppose it is 4.7. Rounding up will be the 5.05 water molecules of crystallization.
Solve these questions.